If there's one thing I would love to kick this off with, is just to encourage you to know that, listen, God is in charge. You don't have to worry about a thing. We can trust that even in the midst of this crisis, God has a great purpose, and God can do great things in the midst of incredible turmoil. So I just want to encourage you on that, and I think we'll hear that when we get in our word today. Also, too, if you got a second or two, if you would just give a digital welcome or a shout out to somebody that you recognize, or maybe somebody you don't recognize, just give them a nice, warm digital welcome, because you know that's how we do at Christ Community. We want to continue that spirit as well online. Also, you can get the sermon notes to this sermon in the description box, and as well as in the church app, so you still can stay connected in terms of what we're communicating. I'm just excited that you've tuned in to watch. This is a great experience. God's going to do a great work. We're going to jump into this word.
I just don't want to get up here on Sundays every now and again and sing before you. That's not pleasing to him. I want to live a life that is pleasing to him.
Amen.
So this song says, God, draw me close to you. Never let me go, God. Is that your prayer today, to be closer to God? We pray that this song ministers to you.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. You are my desire.
order to experience the spiritual vitality that God wants us to experience. And so if you remember in Exodus 16, God told Israel, he says, look, I'm going to feed you every day for 6 days. I'm going to rain down manna, bread from heaven. And I'm going to feed you for 6 days. On the sixth day, I'm going to give you twice as much manna. And I want you to gather up all that manna so that when the seventh day comes, you can rest. You won't have to gather any food, won't have to gather any bread. You'll have enough that will carry you over. And Exodus 16 tells us that Moses gave that instruction to the people, but when the Sabbath came, there were many people that went out and gathered on the Sabbath. And what's amazing, all those people heard the same sermon that Moses preached. Matter of fact, I would argue that in that church service, they told Moses, ooh, that's wonderful. We don't even have to work on the seventh day. I'm going to be sure to make sure I take advantage of this day off. But the question is, yeah, why did they go out and really gather food when God told them not to do it? Because people, you got to understand, when you've been in bondage for 400 years and you've never had a day off, sometimes the rhythms of Egypt are so hardwired in you, you will instinctively do what you know mentally you ought not do. And many times, I think that's what we're seeing today. All the panic, all the fear, all the fighting, all the arguing, the chaos in our culture. That's the rhythm of Egypt. And many times, Christians, unaware, don't even realize they have bought into the same rhythm. And they wonder why they're so anxious. They wonder why they're so stressed. They wonder why they don't have peace. Maybe you have these unforced, unaware rhythms in your heart. And God uses this crisis to get us to pause and to think about the rhythms. And I think more than anything, that's a loving God. Did God send the coronavirus crisis? No, I don't believe that. God loves us too much. But sometimes God will allow trouble because that's what it takes to get our attention. And who knows, maybe what God is doing in this moment, he's allowing the trouble because he sees the turmoil in our hearts and he doesn't want us to be a people of turmoil. He wants us to be a people of joy. And sometimes it takes a crisis. It takes that Sabbath stop to get me to stop and pause and recognize that maybe this is a turning point. Maybe this is a time that I need to think about my rhythms and readjust them in such a way that they're aligned and consistent with God. And so some of you that are watching even right now, maybe the real issue behind the crisis is not that God's trying to get you, but God loves you too much for you not to be saved. Maybe this is your salvation moment. Maybe this is your time to get saved. Maybe God has been so good to you and you experienced some of the prosperity that America has experienced in the last 2 to 3 years. And the truth is, God did a lot of good things and showered a lot of wonderful things in your life. But the truth is, that didn't move you. So thank God that God loves you enough to say, you know what? I'll bring a little crisis if that's what causes you to stop and pause and recognize how much you need me. And so for some of us, maybe this is a time to trust Christ. Maybe it took a crisis to really open your eyes and to see, you know what, you really need the Lord. And I pray that you would trust him today. But maybe for some of us, it's a time of repentance. Maybe the truth is, we're kind of like Israel. We're following God. We're out in this wilderness. We're trying to walk with him. But the truth is, as we try to adjust our rhythm with God, we still have some old rhythms in us, whether unaware or aware, we're kind of holding on to. They're like the old wineskins of the past, holding on to them. And God is saying it's time to tear up those rhythms, tear up those old wineskins so I can give you some new wineskins and put some new wine and do some new things in your life. And for some of us, maybe it's a time of repentance. But then others, maybe it's a time of just completely renewed faith. Too many of us respond to the crises, and too many of us are dictated and controlled by the crises in the moment. Too many of us feel the sky is falling when God is in charge. And God wants us to be a people that says, the world can fall around me, but the God I serve will hold me up.
And many times we miss that this is the power of the gospel. The gospel is not in my life simply to eliminate trouble in my life. No, the gospel says I can hold you up in the midst of your trouble. I can give you peace in the midst of your storm. And while everything else is falling apart around you, God gives you the peace and the strength to sustain you and keep you. And so the writer was right. Thou will keep him in perfect peace, the scripture says, whose mind is stayed on thee. And while the world is falling apart around us, we still have the peace of God. Stand on that joy. That's where the joy comes. And we're defined by him. Stand on that joy. Stand together. Stand on Jesus. And here what I mean by standing on Jesus, number three, is about his return. It says in verse 5, the Lord is near. The Lord is near. And there's two elements there, but the primary element is eschatological. It speaks to the future return of Christ. Jesus, in his Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24, he says, no man knows the hour, but I'm coming back. I'm coming back. Make no mistake, the one who rose from the dead will come back. And when he comes back, he will inaugurate a kingdom. Matter of fact, the last words that Luke records in Acts chapter 1, verse 8 and 9, he tells the disciples, and you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses in both Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost part of the earth. And in the next verse, verse 9, the Bible says, Jesus ascended to heaven, and the disciples stood there with their eyes gazing up into the heavens, looking beyond belief, said, oh my goodness, he's gone. And almost as if that they would stand there for the rest of eternity, two angels showed up and said, look, this same Jesus who you have seen ascended will also return in the same manner. My brothers and sisters, trust me, in spite of all the chaos we may see in our culture, God is coming back. Christ is coming back, and he will set everything in order. He told us these things in Matthew 24 that we don't even have to be afraid. He said there's going to be rumors of wars. There's going to be wars. There's going to be pestilence. There's going to be famine. And he said in his word, don't be afraid. He says, because these things must take place, but it is not the end. So he's prepared us and he has warned us. But stand on Jesus. The Lord is near in that. Maybe the crisis is a time of intimacy with him. Maybe it is a time when God is drawing us closer to him. Because the truth is, for many of us, you know, sometimes it's in the crises that we grow closer to him. I'm reminded of the story about Peter and the disciples, and they were on the Sea of Galilee, and a storm arose, and you would think that boat was about to topsize. And the Bible says, in the midst or in the distance, they saw someone walking on the water, and it was Jesus. And Peter saw him, and when he saw Jesus, he said, Lord, bid me to come. And Jesus said, come. And Peter stepped out of that boat in the midst of that storm and began to walk on water just like Jesus. But about three-quarters of the way, maybe about 80% of the way, the Bible says, when Peter saw the winds and the waves, he began to sink. And then at the last minute, Jesus caught him before he was to go under. And many times when we read that story, we hear that story, we think about the fact that, you know what, Peter was doing all right, but if he had kept his eyes on Jesus, he'd have been all right. And that is true. He should have kept his eyes on Jesus, and he never would have sunk. And many times in life, we can kind of get busy, get caught up in our routines, and we take our eyes off Jesus and focus on something else, and we find ourselves in a difficult place. But I think something else is going on in that text, because many times we don't remember that there were 11 other disciples that stayed in the boat. But Peter here said, if walking on water in a storm is the risk I got to take to get closer to Jesus, that's what I'll do. If it takes a crisis or a storm to bring me closer to Jesus, I'm willing to do it. In other words, Peter said this, I'd rather be in water, in a storm, close to Jesus, than in a boat, in a storm, without Jesus. And we don't want to admit it, y'all, but truly the place of comfort is in the boat. But sometimes God will use the inconvenience of a storm to move me to a place where I can trust him, where I can lean on him, where I can experience his power. And it's only when I step out of my place of comfort that the power of God begins to rise up in me. And so maybe that's what God is doing in this crisis, teaching us to stand on the Lord, stand on Jesus, because his return is near. Lastly, I'm going to wrap this thing up. Stand together, stand in joy, stand on Jesus, stand on prayer. And this verse in verse 6-9, Paul tells us, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your heart and minds in Christ Jesus. And then he goes on and talks about all the good things that can come out of that. Focus on these things, the good. And really, it's a word about how prayer works, that in the midst of the crises, in the midst of the difficulty, when I seek him in prayer, when I stand on Jesus and seek him, the good and the witness of God begins to show up in my life. Or better, the witness of God shows up in community. So even in this shift, because I think what God is doing for the church is that maybe he's shifting us to do faith in a digital world. And the question becomes, can we be light in a digital dark world? And so we're called to be light, but the question is, what does our faith look like in a digital world? And so here it is, a call to prayer. And so I'll just reiterate what our plan is for the coming days, starting Monday, March 16th, 2020. We will kick off 14 days of prayer at Facebook Live right here. And we will do it at noon every day for 14 days. Because I believe that sometimes God can use a crisis to bring about his glory. I believe in this crisis, people are going to come to Christ. I believe in this crisis that people are going to be transformed. I believe in this crisis that those Christians that are marginal have kind of been on the outskirts, they will be brought into the fold. I believe in a crisis God will bring about unity. I believe in a crisis that God will deal with the injustices that we see in this country and around the world. I believe that God wants to use the crisis and the people of God engaged in prayer and engaged in community to shake up this world in a way that makes this world a better place. And so let's meet for prayer and let's see what God does and let's trust him. Again, that's noon, Facebook Live. We'll be right here praying together in this crisis. If I can close with this before I give the gospel, I'd like to leave you with this thought about what God is doing. I had an opportunity a couple of weeks ago to go to a charitable event. It was actually a professional boxing match, but it was a charity. It was a charity in which those who were in attendance had an opportunity to make donations to a particular boys club. My friend Will McCall gives leadership to Dallas Leadership Foundation, and his foundation was throwing this charity event, and it featured professional boxing, but there they were raising funds to give to those kids an alternative from the streets where they can learn about boxing and sports and all kinds of things, and they used the event to raise funds for the kids. And so I don't know a whole lot about boxing. I'm not an avid boxing fan by any stretch of the imagination, but there was one bout we were watching, two young professional boxers, and I'll just say boxer one and boxer two. And it was clear that boxer one was much more quicker than boxer two. He was quicker, he was faster, he was dancing, and he was really hitting boxer two anytime he wanted to. And so I blurted out the statement. I said, oh, boxer two is in trouble because boxer one is just tagging him. And a young man that was sitting at our table, was a member of the Potter's House, and we had a chance to meet and share a little bit, and wonderful brother, and he had been following boxing for 20 years, and he said, Pastor, with all due respect, I need to tell you, you don't know what you're talking about. I said, what are you talking about? It's clear that boxer one is tagging boxer two. I don't think he's going to last too long. He said, give it about 3 or 4 rounds. And I guarantee you that boxer two will probably knock boxer one out. I didn't believe him. And so I watched the fight, and boxer one, as he kept on boxing, it was clear that he started getting tired. He started laboring heavily with his breathing. And before the fight was over, by the 6th round, boxer two knocked
boxer one out and won the match. And I just looked at my friend. I said, man, how did you know that? He said, it's only one thing and one thing only. He says, boxing is not about quickness. Boxing is not just about quick hands. He says, boxing is about legs. And boxer two had the legs and the strength to endure all the blows and to deliver the blows that would knock boxer one out. And if there's one word I can leave for the people of God, I know we're dealing with this boxer one called the coronavirus. But if we have God on our side, he has given us the legs in which we can withstand any blow that the virus throws at us. And in the end, we will get the victory. God bless you. May God keep you. Amen. And so we're in a pretty interesting time, a little bit chaotic, a little bit of a crisis. And the natural question is, what is God doing? Well, here's what I do know. God loves you, and God has a purpose for your life. And even in the worst conditions, God can do something amazing in your life. And that's the gospel. If you're watching today and you've never trusted Christ, you're not a follower, you're not a Christian, the good news is this is your moment. And if you believe the gospel, God will come into your life, walk with you, bring you purpose, but also he will bring you to a place in the afterlife as well. The gospel is very simple. Christ died for our sins and rose from the dead. And the Bible teaches if you believe that, he will save you. And so if you're watching right now, you're not a Christian, you're not a follower, this is your moment. And I want to lead you through this simple prayer, very simple prayer. And if you believe it and you want to repeat it after me, just bow your head for a moment of prayer and I'll lead you through it. And you sense God moving on your heart as you watch this and you pray this prayer, guess what? He'll save you. He'll make you a follower. He'll make you a Christian and he'll be with you in the midst of this crisis. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we bless you and thank you again for this moment. We thank you for the gospel. And somebody's watching right now, Lord, who's never trusted you, who's not a Christian, but maybe they want to trust you now. So if that's you and you want to trust Christ, simply repeat these words after me. And you repeat them believing God will save you. There are people praying for you right now, even as you're watching. Simply repeat these words after me. Lord Jesus, I believe you died and rose for my sins. Thank you for forgiveness and salvation. I accept you as my Savior and Lord to make a difference in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. We celebrate you. We thank God for you. If you've prayed that prayer for the very first time, God bless you. The angels in heaven are throwing a party because you've been made a part of the family of God. We would love to follow up with you or share with you if you want to find out more information about what God is doing in your life and how we can help you with that journey, please hit us with an email at admin@ccrichardson.org. We'll follow up with you. Lastly, just a few summary. I want to just thank all of you for watching. If you would you be so kind to like us and subscribe to us or share us or hit that bell notification for us or make a comment there about the message, the service, and how it may have influenced you or impacted you in a wonderful way. We surely would appreciate it. God bless you, and may God keep you. Final note, starting Monday, March 16th, we will be praying on Facebook Live for the next 14 days.